Dombey and Son by Charles Dickens. Prefaces of 1848 and 1867. Preface of 1848. I cannot forgo my usual opportunity of saying farewell to my readers in this greeting place, though I have only to acknowledge the unbounded warmth and earnestness of their sympathy in every stage of the journey we have just concluded. If any of them have felt a sorrow in one of the principal incidents on which this fiction turns, I hope it may be a sorrow of that sort which endears the sharers in it one to another. This is not unselfish in me. I may claim to have felt it, at least as much as anybody else, and I would fain be remembered kindly for my part in the experience. Devonshire Terrace, 24th March, 1848. End of Preface of 1848. Preface of 1867. I make so bold as to believe that the faculty, or the habit, of correctly observing the characters of men, is a rare one. I have not even found within my experience that the faculty, or the habit, of correctly observing so much as the faces of men, is a general one by any means. The two commonest mistakes in judgment that I suppose to arise from the former default are the confounding of shyness with arrogance, a very common mistake indeed, and the not understanding that an obstinate nature exists in a perpetual struggle with itself. Mr. Dombey undergoes no violent change, either in this book or in real life. A sense of his injustice is within him all along. The more he represses it, the more unjust he necessarily is. Internal shame and external circumstances may bring the contest to a close in a week or a day, but it has been a contest for years, and it is only fought out after a long balance of victory. I began this book by the Lake of Geneva, and went on with it for some months in France, before pursuing it in England. The association between the writing and the place of writing is so curiously strong in my mind that at this day, although I know, in my fancy, every stair in the little midshipman's house, and could swear to every pew in the church in which Florence was married, or to every young gentleman's bedstead in Dr. Blimber's establishment, I yet confusedly imagine Captain Cuttle as secluding himself from Mrs. MacStinger among the mountains of Switzerland. Similarly, when I am reminded by any chance of what it was that the waves were always saying, my remembrance wanders for a whole winter night about the streets of Paris, as I restlessly did with a heavy heart on the night when I had written the chapter in which my little friend and I parted company. End of Preface of 1867. Chapter 1. Dombey and Son. Dombey sat in the corner of the darkened room, in the great armchair by the bedside, and Son lay tucked up warm in a little basket bedstead, carefully disposed on a low settee immediately in front of the fire and close to it, as if his constitution were analogous to that of a muffin, and it was essential to toast him brown while he was very new. Dombey was about 8-and-40 years of age, Son about 8-and-40 minutes. Dombey was rather bald, rather red, and though a handsome, well-made man, too stern and pompous in appearance to be prepossessing. Son was very bald and very red, and though, of course, an undeniably fine infant, somewhat crushed and spotty in his general effect, as yet. On the brow of Dombey, time and his brother Care had set some marks, as on a tree that was to come down in good time. Remorseless twins they are for striding through their human forests, notching as they go, while the countenance of Son was crossed with a thousand little creases, which the same deceitful time would take delight in smoothing out and wearing away with the flat part of his scythe, as a preparation of the surface for his deeper operations. Dombey, exulting in the long-looked-for event, jingled and jingled the heavy gold watch-chain that depended from below his trim blue coat, whereof the buttons sparkled phosphorescently in the feeble rays of the distant fire. Sun, with his little fists curled up and clenched, seemed, in his feeble way, to be squaring at existence for having come upon him so unexpectedly.
"The house will once again, Mrs. Dombey," said Mr. Dombey, "be not only in name, but in fact, Dombey and Son."
And he added in a tone of luxurious satisfaction, with his eyes half closed as if he were reading the name in a device of flowers, and inhaling their fragrance at the same time,
"Dombey and Son."
The words had such a softening influence that he appended a term of endearment to Mrs. Dombey's name, though not without some hesitation, as being a man but little used to that form of address, and said,
"Mrs. Dombey, my dear."
A transient flush of faint surprise overspread the sick lady's face as she raised her eyes towards him.
"He will be christened Paul, my Mrs. Dombey, of course."
She feebly echoed, "Of course," or rather expressed it by the motion of her lips, and closed her eyes again.
"His father's name, Mrs. Dombey, and his grandfather's. I wish his grandfather were alive this day. There is some inconvenience in the necessity of writing Junior," said Mr. Dombey, making a fictitious autograph on his knee. "But it is merely of a private and personal complexion. It doesn't enter into the correspondence of the house. Its signature remains the same."
And again he said,
"Dombey and Son,"
in exactly the same tone as before. Those three words conveyed the one idea of Mr. Dombey's life. The earth was made for Dombey and Son to trade in, and the sun and moon were made to give them light. Rivers and seas were formed to float their ships. Rainbows gave them promise of fair weather. Winds blew for or against their enterprises. Stars and planets circled in their orbits to preserve inviolate a system of which they were the centre. Common abbreviations took new meanings in his eyes, and had sole reference to them. A.D. had no concern with Anno Domini, but stood for Anno Dombey and Son. He had risen, as his father had before him, in the course of life and death, from Son to Dombey, and for nearly 20 years had been the sole representative of the firm. Of those years he had been married 10, married, as some said, to a lady with no heart to give him, whose happiness was in the past, and who was content to bind her broken spirit to the dutiful and meek endurance of the present. Such idle talk was little likely to reach the ears of Mr. Dombey.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.